May the peace of God be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a tiller of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel, for his part, brought of the firstlings of his flock, their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it." Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let us go out to the field." And when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it will no longer yield to you its strength. You will be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Today you have driven me away from the soil, and I shall be hidden from your face. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and anyone who meets me may kill me." Then the Lord said to him, "Not so. Whoever kills Cain will suffer a sevenfold vengeance." And the Lord put a mark on Cain, so that no one who came upon him would kill him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. The word of the Lord.
I bring you greetings from First Congregational Church of County Ohio, located in the Connecticut Western Reserve. We came from Connecticut and Massachusetts and settled in that Connecticut Western Reserve many, many, many years ago. I'm honored to be here and grateful for the opportunity to bring this message. In a way, this is sort of a homecoming. I earned my doctorate of ministry here at the School of Theology at Boston University. And as I approached this pulpit, I got terribly excited. And I hope it doesn't manifest in my voice. I want to celebrate and recognize our international students here at Boston University. And if any of you are present this morning, please stand. Thank you. Thank you. You remind me of the richness that an academic community, the city of Boston, and just being here enriches my life and enriches the life of our world. Because of its diversity, but also because it reminds us that we are one. We may come from different nations and different places and different journeys in life. We find our oneness in the Creator through Jesus Christ. Would you bow your heads and open your hearts and join with me in prayer? Almighty God, as I stand before you and your people this day, I offer my words as containers of your truth. And where I fail, forgive me, touch the hearts of our listeners with your Holy Spirit, that we hear with new ears and see with new eyes your words of life. Christ's name we pray. Amen. It is not coincidental that I am here during this week in November when we remember those who have served in the military. For the United States, we refer to this as Veterans Day. For other nations who were involved in World War I, it is known as Remembrance. day not for celebration on November 11th, but rather a day for reflection. War is nothing to celebrate. On the 11th month, the 11th day at the 11th hour in 1918, the armistice was signed, ending World War I, the war to end all wars. And we know how that's turned out. At First Congregational Church of Talmadge, we started a ministry specialized in bringing healing to our veterans, their families, and the wider community. And that ministry is titled Warrior's Journey Home. Listen, speak, heal. I was honored to sit in Dr. Ramfield's class last evening and engage fellow students, and I can't tell you how much I learned from them. I was blessed. This ministry of Warrior's Journey Home addresses a question that was raised in Dr. Ramfield's book, Spirit of Trauma. How does one live in the time between death and life? We may think of that as Holy Saturday between the execution of Jesus of Nazareth and Resurrection Sunday. But do not think of Holy Saturday as one day. Think of it more as a timeless place for many of our veterans. In much of the Protestant Christian churches, the message is about the resurrection, which is proclaimed, and of course that is an important facet of our faith, a tenet of our faith. But often that proclamation escapes the reality of traumatizing suffering, and things are glossed over. The ministry of Warrior's Journey Home is a ministry of remaining. And I would like to tell you a story of how the seed was planted in my heart. In the year 2000, a Vietnam veteran came to my office on the encouragement of his VA psychiatrist and other doctors. They informed him that his persistent psychological issues were ultimately with God. But it was a God that he no longer believed in. A God who he felt had abandoned him and forsaken him some 40 years earlier. He grew up in Akron, Ohio, was raised in a Christian family, and was active in his church following high school graduation. He was conscripted in military service, and after basic training and advanced individual training as an infantryman, he was assigned to Company C, 1st Battalion, 20th Infantry Regiment, the 11th Brigade of the 23rd Infantry Division. We know that as the AmeriCap Division. He was sent to Vietnam at the age of 19. His company received combat operations orders to a hamlet called San Mi, Vietnam. And on March 16th, 1968, as a machine gunner, he killed, as he was ordered to do, women and children and non-combatant men. The hamlet of San Mi, Vietnam, is known in the United States as My Lai. I met with this veteran and his wife for 2 hours. Before he left my office, I told him there wasn't anything I could do to help him. I thanked him for his service. And because I, too, had served in the Army from 1974 to 1978, I thought perhaps in some way because he served ahead of me, I did not have to go to Vietnam. I also told him that what he did was criminal. And he expressed his gratitude for someone who was telling him the truth. I told him that although I could not do anything to help him because I didn't know what to do and I felt terribly impotent, I said, I will walk through your hell with you as a companion. When he left my office, I exhaled a simple breath of prayer. God help us. How can we do this to our people? Show me what to do. One necessary understanding of the ministry that surfaced was that this is a community issue and not the individual's pathological disorder. And this was not a deleterious problem. Post-traumatic stress endured by our veterans, that place of suffering in the in-between place of death and life, is our problem as a community, as a people. And it has affected our entire nation, from every institution, from schools, through churches, through business. Post-traumatic stress is our problem. The ministry of Warriors Journey Home enters into the suffering of those who have borne the brunt of military service. And this has always been a part of our religious tradition. Walter Brueggemann writes, in Reverberations of Faith, Israel's sense of community is in their understanding of covenant. As a people, they convened and were given life by God and summoned to live in faithful obedience. Covenant is an articulation of that defining relationship. However, community has to live amidst the characteristics and troubles and tribulations of life in a variety of social, economic, political relationships. The trick of community is to hold together real differences of interest in the midst of treasuring a passionate commitment to belong to one another. In other words, living in community is necessary and also terribly messy. This would define the early communities of followers of Jesus and his teachings. The early church, from my understanding of scripture and the stories. Maladome Patrice Somme, a tribal elder from a West African tribe, writes in The Healing Wisdom of Africa, community is important because there is an understanding that human beings are collectively oriented. The general health and well-being of an individual is connected to a community and are not something that can be maintained in a vacuum. Healing, ritual, and community. These three elements are vitally linked. For our veterans and their families and those who are directly affected by the scourge of warfare, by just being in military service sometimes, needs the community to help them find healing, to allow God's healing presence to move through us into the lives of heart and soul. The word redemption carries one definition of repair. The question is, how do we do that? In the Gospel according to Mark, we remember the story of the paralytic. We remember that some friends hear about Jesus of Nazareth, who was in a home, and anxious to have their friend find some healing. They can't get close to Jesus, so they go up on the roof and they cut a hole through the roof and diminish the value of the home, probably, I guess. They lower their friend on a pallet to the feet of Jesus. And you're familiar with the story. He forgives the paralytic's sins. To the alarm of the religious leaders, only God can forgive sins. And Jesus, in his engagement, says, well, which is easier, to forgive sins or to say, pick up your pallet? And so he says, to prove to you that I have the power to forgive sins, pick up your pallet and go home. Now the key here is he sends him home. He doesn't send him to coffee hour after the meeting. Go home. Just imagine what going home meant to this paralytic. But it was the community of his friends, and it was a return to community that there was like something could not be completed until he returned home. In the Gospel according to Luke, there are several stories of lepers finding healing when they come into the presence of Jesus. And in those instances, Jesus sent the lepers back to their community. Present yourself to the priest. Follow that ritual tradition, the protocol, and find that healing that becomes complete. In John's Gospel, there's a man born blind, and Jesus makes a little bit of mud out of his spit and dirt, puts it on the man's eyes and says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. And we know the end of that story, how the community has a difficult time accepting the healing that's taking place for the man who's been born blind. There's wisdom in the creation stories that speaks, it is not good for us to be alone. We are made for one another. But when we alienate an individual based on how they look or what they've done or where they come from, there is a slow, painful death. A person will remain in that in-between place, in that God-forsaken place that I refer to as hell. Welcome home parades for our veterans are nice. Free dining at Denny's is nice. 10% discount at Bob Evans is nice. But it does not bring the veteran home. We must enter into that suffering with them. We can learn from ancient warrior cultures. When there was a threat, a real threat to the community, the warriors would be summoned to surround that village and to protect those who could not protect themselves. And when that threat was eliminated or when it passed by, the civilians, the people of Strong Heart, knew that there was this unwritten social contract that when you, warrior, come back inside the protected perimeter of the village, we need to protect you. And through different rituals that were their, part of their spiritual practices, they would do their storytelling, they would do dances, they would do artwork. And they would find cleansing and purification and restoration and redemption and become a different member of that community. Someone who had new wisdom, new insight. Modern warfare has changed that. Soldiers oftentimes are not viewed as warriors. Being a warrior is a noble cause. Michael Mead, in a recent interview in Sun Magazine, reminded me that soldiers are trained to follow orders. Warriors will work in the best interest of their people. So many times I hear from our veterans, why are we here? Why were we in that country? Why were we doing these things? And when we ask that question, we question the noble cause for which we enlisted or for which motivated us to serve. And when we question the nobility of our cause and our purpose, we sustain a moral injury. The power of ceremony, the power of community is important. In October of 2010, a group from Warriors journeyed home. Church members, non-church members, stood at the ground of Camp Eagle in Vietnam. Camp Eagle was an American military base here in the city of Phu Bai. It supported combat operations of the Marines and the Army. Near the site, we conducted a ceremony. And we called all the wandering souls home. For those who had fought and died there, both Vietnamese, Viet Cong, North Vietnamese, for Americans, we called them to come home. On that hallowed ground, I felt strangely moved. And I reminded the people in our group of the Cain and Abel story. question to Cain, what have you done? And it's never stopped. Mother Earth, which we all belong to, cries out with the blood of her children. War and killing pains God. Yet God does not abandon us. Everything God created is good. And we desecrate all that goodness. We desecrate all that is holy and sacred. Our prayer as we stood on that area of Camp Eagle was not only for the soldiers who died there, but also for their families and for the widows and orphans that we made. We pray for a reconsecration of the earth and for forgiveness and to be changed. On the 11th month, 11th day, the 11th hour, 1918, the armistice was signed at the end of World War I. 1 year later, President Woodrow Wilson named November 11th as Armistice Day. And on June 5th, 1954, the Congress changed the wording from Armistice to Veterans Day to help us remember all veterans who have served at any time, in any place, in any way. There's a need for peace, but there needs to be a peace that comes from the healing of the wounds of war. And that healing will take place when every veteran comes home. I'd like to share with you a poem written by a man who's been homeless for 45 years, a Vietnam veteran, served in the Marine Corps in Vietnam. This is titled Homesick. He's not been back to Ohio since his service in Vietnam. Delayed stress reaction like a plague, plummeting to the depths where nothing is vague. Thoughts of Vietnam are memories harassed, haunting memories from hell's past. Overpowering to the mental state of mind, the realization it can never be left behind. Are we in the jungle or in the USA? Our minds on the past, snatched from today. Taken back to the time insane, holding on to reality becomes a strain. Tentacles from now embedded in our subconscious, pulling us back, rendering us unconscious. What kind of stress could cause such a reaction? Is our knowledge real or is it fiction? Why were we there? What was the reason? Was it patriotism or was it treason? Delayed stress is triggered by a realization. Economic war, controlled extermination. We are confused by how we were used, souls torn apart and our lives abused, minds held in check like prisoners of war, survival in itself a supreme chore. Through the desert of life we continually roam. While in none, we lost our home. Written by Afterburner 26 Bravo, he asked not to use his name, but his call sign. As followers of Jesus, we are called to accompany others in their suffering. As Serene Jones points out, suffering is not the source of redemption. Instead, it is the persistence of love in the midst of suffering. Love remains. When I sit in sacred ceremony with our veterans and their families, I do not hear war stories. I listen to love stories. I listen to love stories of affection for their people, for their families, for their country, for the men and women who served with them, that they wanted to bring home. The homecoming will take place when the people of strong heart receive them and protect them. I would like any of our veterans in the congregation, anyone who served in the military, could you please stand? Would the nearest person of strong heart stand next to you? And now would you face each other and looking that person in the eye like you to say, if you are a veteran, say to this person, look them in the eye, I serve to protect you. And you have a strong heart. Look your veteran in the eye and say, I am here to protect you. Welcome home. Thank you. Amen.
I would like to invite the loveless Reverend John Frank to lead us in prayer.
On these days where we honor the veteran service, I think of one person, Corman Ricky Scott, who died on the last day, the last hour, the last battle in Vietnam. He was a conscientious objector who would not carry a weapon, but was a corpsman. And he died, caring for another. I cannot help but think of Ricky Scott on these days when we hold each other in prayer. Take a moment and think of those you know who have come before you, who are presently serving our country in any way that we can serve one another and God and our country. Take a moment.
Thank you.
face shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and bring you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.